Happening so cool. And I didn't want to sing in that spot. Are you doing this? Are you going to the A? Oh, yeah. You're supposed to be playing real simple. You're supposed to really just play that instead of all the chords.
The notes?
Yeah.
Well, if your fucking keyboard was down like toward like a normal place, you know what I mean? I could,
And then you could go in there like on Janie's Got a Gun and work all those arpeggios out as the track's getting built and stuff.
Yeah.
No.
So here we go.
Four strings.
Anything like four play?
Oh yeah.
It's is that what pump
too.
Means?
No, pump. What pump means is what this record is.
The difference between us old farts and the younger bands is that the younger bands are into jerking off and we're into fucking.
I don't believe in censoring any of these songs.
What the focus is.
Focus what is to do an album here? As good as I can get.
It's a full circle album. The band had a progression of albums in the 70s leading up to the album Rocks, where everyone got better, and our style got more and more boiled down to its essence. Then, you know, we started getting distracted. We started getting corrupt. And all of a sudden our albums didn't progress. Each album wasn't better than the last one. And finally the band broke up for 3 years. Then when we got back together, you know, we didn't just come out with an album that was the next logical step. You know, we were like a new band. We had to start the evolutionary process again.
Well, I think that what we wanted to do was just get in the and get closer to what we thought a good Aerosmith record would be, or the best Aerosmith record. And I think we got close with Permanent Vacation, but there was a lot of deadwood. You know, we put 13 songs on the record, and a lot of them didn't. We never played them even live, and to me that was a waste of time and a waste of music and a waste of plastic. And what we wanted to do was just get closer to what Aerosmith is about and have songs that translate really well in all the mediums, whether it's video, airplay, or playing them live.
And we just jammed and wailed. And when we got on a groove, that was it. Because that's what we wanted more than anything else on this album, was to have a lot of Aerosmith grooves that we could take to the stage and not be pretentious and not be the commercial hit and what everybody was waiting for. Just a little bit more of that sawtooth rough edge that Aerosmith was known for.
No, that ain't bad enough, motherfucker!
Joe Perry, I bounce off of as, you know, is this cool? I don't know whatever happened to him in his life, but whatever it is, he's way different than I am. And I like it. And I can't be that way. You know, I can get close to him, I dangle a cigarette in my mouth. But I can't think the way he does, so I gotta bounce stuff off him. That's the side I don't have. It's like I saw this Star Trek, right, where Kirk was the bad guy and the good guy. And the good guy was going, but please, the other guy was like ramming this phaser up his butthole. And so they started both dying. You see, because somehow in the transporter had split them up and they were dying on their own. Hate was, you know, a little bit of mixture of the two made everything work just right, and that's what Joe Perry is for me.
I suppose one phrase that could describe how we make records is just try it. You know, we have a process that we wind up going into to make records, and generally it's just like an extended jam. Joe and Steven generally get together and come up with some, you know, raw arrangements, and the rest of us will come in with our stray ideas. And then we just start, you know, we'll take a small, specific part of a musical idea and we'll jam on it and just play it until, you know, everybody's arms are in flames and turn a small thing into a monster.
Aerosmith is like the vehicle that allows me to be all that I can be. Whatever I think I want, whatever I want to be, Aerosmith allows me to be it. You know, and have a good time doing it. You know, it's just, it's like, I used to think, you know, why am I keeping this alive? Why do I want to start up with a band again? Because it's like, it's the only thing I really know. You know, we're married. It's a marriage, the five of us. But more than that, once you get past the egos, which is nuts to say, but the real bottom line is the music that we make together. You know, it's like you get these 10 kids and they're all playing in the same sand, but when they're finished, they got this castle built.
Everybody's got their little studios and like their four tracks and pulls little bits and pieces that they add to the soup, but the actual scheduled rehearsals start, and Steven and I usually start coming up with ideas, and then after a certain amount of time, when we feel it's ready, then we start bringing everybody else in, you know, and all along people are working with other people, and that's kind of how it goes.
It's almost impossible to have a cassette rolling and be able to take the cassette and play it back, and you know, because you've got 6 or 7 hours on it. So we decided putting 1-1. That was the first day. So anything on that first cassette was the first day. We figured if we did that for 2 or 3 months, we'd have the album. And we did. 1-1 was a song called Monkey on My Back.
Drums come in. Yeah, it's like four. The drums.
first start writing the songs, we both get kind of an individual idea about what kind of sounds we're going to go for. You know, for me, a lot of how I write the songs and the riffs comes from the particular guitar sound. You know, if I have a guitar that I think is, it's got a really cool sound, or if it's got a good color to it and I want to play it on stage, I write a song around it.
It's a fuel. When Joe Perry plays this guitar for me, I think that, to me, that's just an incredible thing to watch and to hear. And I think that happens for Tom Hamilton and Joey Kramer and Steve and everybody, and it goes back and forth. We like so much of what we're all doing together. I mean, I can't tell you how many times Steven goes, "What was that? What did you play?" You know, this is why we found out we have to keep tape recorders running all the time, because, you know, you being a guitar player, you're playing stuff, and I go, "I don't know, Steven." He goes, "Well, what was it? You just played it." And I go, "I don't know." You know, sometimes you're just fooling around. You're just like an artist. You're just doodling, you know. But there's flashes of brilliance happening all the time.
I don't think that people in general really realize what an incredible guitar player Brad really is. Because he's a quiet kind of guy, you know. And his influence, you know, shows in songs all over the place, starting back on Rocks, you know, with songs like Round and Round and the original riff from Nobody's Fault, to Voodoo Medicine Man on the Pump record. The forte of his playing lends itself to the style of Joe's playing, and then the way that they complement themselves back and forth is what really makes the band, what the band is really all about, because Aerosmith is really a guitar band.
Brad's playing doesn't come from insanity. It comes from a schooled thing. You know, he learned it and he built on the learning. But Joe, like, you know, he never took any lessons or anything like that. He built it out of anger and want of a girlfriend and not that Brad didn't, but it's a different type of thing that's real black, and I like that. about Aerosmith personally was the diversity. Someone called Janie's Got a Gun is gonna be. It's so good. Well, I think we're gonna do. You might be loving an elevator. Heh. Yeah, that's the name of the song. No, I said it might be loving an elevator. Yeah. Loving an elevator! Yeah, it's a good thing.
But that's what this is.
It's a traditional kind of traditional funk.
Yeah.
Sort of in a traditional kind of traditional way.
Traditionally speaking.
Yeah. Look, in the 70s we would tour for like, a year solid. We would do two or three shows a day off. We do that for a year and a half. And, when you got cocaine to sniff and booze and pussy to fuck and all that shit, and it's like, it makes it real easy.
It's the rhythmic quality of it. But it gives it a real flavor. You have lots of those A's and E's and O's.
Yeah, it's pretty nuts. It's nuts, but I did drugs for like 25 years, so I had a problem stopping because I was just so fucking used to it. It's like living in the water all your life and coming out and living on land and saying, oh, I'm fine, I can function fine. Every other minute, you're thinking about going back into the water. It's fucking crazy, but, I was really fortunate enough to see that it was stifling my creativity, and that's what I was in a band for, was because I saw the Stones, and I saw the Yardbirds, and I said, fuck, not only do I love that, or what they're doing, but I want to do it too, and I want to do it better. I think I can do it better.
Basically, we were all ensconced in this little studio, this tiny studio in Cohasset, Massachusetts, which is kind of just an out-of-the-way little town. And it was sort of isolated for us, which is a good way to work, really, when you really have to get a lot of this, busy work done of, arrangements, which is a lot of, kind of the ditch digging of an album, putting those arrangements together and rehearsing them. Everybody would slog in the morning, kick the snow off their shoes, and every couple of weeks Bruce would show up, and he'd come in not showing a trace of jet lag, even though he'd flown in all the way from Vancouver. And we'd get right to work seeing where the band was at, with the songs he had asked us to concentrate on. Picture us there in Cohasset, and Steven's over behind his keyboard, kind of sitting up in his royal chair there. And everybody's, every time we come to rehearsal, everybody pretty much winds up in the same position, And Steven is kind of the master of ceremonies. A lot of times he'll either be playing his keyboard or he'll just be listening while the rest of us are playing. And it's kind of a lucky thing because when you're in a situation and you're the only person in the room who's not sitting there concentrating on exactly what he's playing, your mind is sometimes a little more free to just start throwing ideas around, and Steven is definitely good at that.
Let's just take it from here. Don't get mad, get even.
Joe, he's kind of off by himself, and he's smoldering away on his guitar, but every once in a while, you know, a bolt of lightning jumps out. And it's very obvious when it happens. And when that happens, you know, everything will stop, and we'll take that and start, you know, working on it, seeing where that, you know, can go to bring the song up another level. And you know, I'm over there, you know, completely absorbed in trying to make the rhythmic aspect of the song happen with Joey. You know, it's kind of a weird thing because as you practice, you're changing the arrangement constantly. Not only are you changing it, but the next time you play it, you've got to remember those changes you made. But at the same time, your mind, you know, is trying to say, how can I take this raw thing that I'm working on, this raw bass part, and make it more interesting?
Yeah, so we get the title coming back, and you could do those stats, you know? Just play it into that.
He's a town planner, Bruce Fairburn. He's the one that says, no, 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 move that bridge. It's no good there. We should put a tunnel there, move the bridge, and that way we can get this point A to point B. He's a town planner, so when I walk in with all my scatterbrain stuff and Brad's got a song, you know, he puts it in his place. He goes, no, go to there, go to here, go to there, and I go, no, Bruce, fuck you. He says, well, why do you feel that way? And we talk it out. So it's just another wall to bounce off of, you know?
Chorus, we just pay off and come in like gangbusters. Now it floats, and then just when you start to get a hold of it, it floats away on it's gone. And it's okay to do that the first time the chorus comes up, because you know, you're teasing a little bit, you know, and you want it. You want it. Next time it comes up, you think, yeah, here it comes.
What he does is he's like, he's very objective about the songs, and he isn't as emotionally attached to them as we are, so it's a lot easier for him to kind of come in and cut and maim and, you know, say, this doesn't work, this is terrible, or this is great, or, you know. And, you know, after, by the end of the album, I usually hate him, you know, because he's so, you know, he's a taskmaster. And but, you know, after a few months, I start looking forward to talking with him again.
That's right, two or three tracks in a day. I mean, it takes you guys fucking nothing to do guitar parts. It's great. Steve's real quick on vocals. I'd rather use the time up front here to see if another hit hits the table, or, you know, another gem comes on writing. You know?
Bruce Fairburn very much is listening for those musical elements that stand out immediately, strong statements. I mean, the generic industry term is hooks. You know, when somebody came to me once and said, you've got a lot of hooks in your music, I knew what they meant, but I was surprised. Because I just thought, you know, a hook, that's a cool riff, you know, or that's a really, that's just a really cool part. I really like this part here, that somebody else might call it a hook. Fine. If you're going to make a living doing this, I suppose they better be in there.
Then we took it to Vancouver and spent about 3 weeks doing kind of pre-production, you know, like actually rehearsing for, you know, like getting the songs down. So, like, we're playing them live. And then we did kind of like a demo tape thing where we put 19 songs on 24 track just to see how they sounded and play them for John Kolodner. And you know, so we could get an idea of where the album was going and if we really needed anything else, you know, if we had all the elements. And then we started recording in earnest. And most of those demo tapes ended up being the bed tracks for the songs.
So consequently, when we were doing the album, when we were finishing up the album, when we went online in Vancouver, we had an A-list and a B-list. Okay, the A-list had The Love in an Elevator, big hit, right? Hey, it's finished, it's happening. What It Takes, big hit. But the stuff like Monkey on My Back, Voodoo Medicine Man, all the B-list stuff was kind of put on the back burner. And I hated that, and I fought for it for months. It worked on a little longer. You yourself said you wouldn't want to spend all day on a song.
No.
So if we don't get a song that just happens to be a little hard, like, you know, hey, whatever.
Yeah, but
and The Walrus by The Beatles took a long time to
do. But also,
if it was approached like this, it would have been put on the back burner. That's all. You can't dismiss that. Is that totally not true?
No.
I mean, I'd have passed on two of these.
Yeah, in
at
that
the studio,
case,
we'd have never wound up doing Sniffing, never wound up doing Monkey on My Back if I didn't go, Jesus. You know, just that little bit of nuts. I don't want to sway anybody. That's how I feel.
The process of picking out which songs to work on is excruciating, fascinating.
Well, in that case, you know, we should go to the York Theater, get an 8-track in there, demo all these songs, finish them.
Why is that? We're doing it here.
Yeah, but it only costs you $50 a day there. Here it's costing you, you know, $1,500.
Well, are you going to let that get in the way of art? Something that might come out and gross you $15 million?
No, obviously not, but I'm just saying, theoretically, all that should have been done before we were here. Like, last album, we had all the songs, I think, we had all the songs kind of up.
No, it was the same thing. Everybody ran to Steve and wasn't ready, but, you know, there's a certain amount of magic there, you know? I mean, if you come in here and it's like, pick it out of a garbage can, everybody be doing it. It's not that easy. It's the hard stuff, you know?
I just think we should do what we set out to do. Get these songs done.
So what do you want to work on tonight?
It's a wicked tense. Are you kidding? It's those are your babies there, and people are coming in and telling you which ones are, you know, going to grow up and which ones aren't. It's hard because, you know, you believe in the songs and you work on them. I mean, we've got songs we've worked on for, you know, over and over and over again, and they just don't make it.
Jim's Ballad, definitely we have to cut, because it's a good song too.
But it doesn't have lyrics on it.
Well, I know. That's the
crime. So, you see, what I'm saying here is, where are you judging?
I'm judging
whether the song is great or not. By what? If you're using the lyrics as a mirror, how can you say that about that?
Well, I'm using the lyrics and the songs on the air. If there were good lyrics for Jim's song, it would be hit.
Some of those songs may stand up like a bit, like Jim's, like that ballad stands up by itself musically to begin with. So, you know, we know it would be that much, it's just going to be that much better.
It's a combination of the music and the lyrics.
Yeah. For example, I don't get that feeling off News for Your Baby. I've heard the lyrics, I've heard the song. To me, it's a good song, but it's not a hit. Good song. But, you know, unless a miracle happened with it, which can happen sometimes, you know, it's not, you know, it's not a great song.
The thing is, though, I mean, I don't see any, I don't know if any one of those songs, I mean, I don't know because they're not done, but how many of those songs will actually knock off any of these when these are done? I mean, there's a reason why they're on the A-list, you know?
Obviously, one of the songs on the A-list was Janie's Got a Gun. Stephen played this demo of this magnificent song that he was working on, and we all said, yeah, that's one we want to work on right away.
I think it starts like this. Jim Balance, he's a master. I mean, he's another guy that, you know, you look at him, he looks like some guy, some old guy, you know, he's some brain, some rocket scientist, but he really knows how to let the kid out and be free. I grew up under the piano, you know, and I use what's inside of me, you know, the God-given gifts and the gifts that I received from my parents and from my father's father, because they're a whole classical musician family, and my father playing these sonatas and all that stuff that's... And so I use that gift as a tool. So I get myself this new age stuff called a Korg. Okay, it's a piano. It's got like 99 presets, different things, everything from the Mormon Tabernacle Choir to slap bass.
Anything you can imagine, you can do. Anything you can imagine.
And suddenly I fell into this Tom Hamilton's thing. That was a little of Tom Hamilton's thing. But I fell into that, and I went into. I'm also a drummer at heart too, so I got all this.
The other thing in the solo is just let him open it up and just bang, bang, bang. You know, let him, rather than being tight with the pushes so much.
Well, again, the structure of it.
Yeah, but feel free maybe, Brad, once you know this, to let it go, because Joe's going to be screaming over top of that, so you want to get some real rave up to kind of from there.
Well, if you fall away from this pattern, Joe's doing that rave up. I'm not going to be sitting on stage playing the piano. You really got to be. It's like building a ladder. You've got two long pieces of wood that gives you the height, and you've got 12 vertical pieces, horizontal pieces. You put the first one in, so you know, you glue it into place and stir, you step up on it, and you put the next one in, and you climb. Before you know it, you can like be at the top gluing in the last one, and you're way up off the ground, you've done the thing. The song was pretty much the same thing, but when I heard Janie's Got a Gun, I thought, well, I gotta fill the blanks in. I don't wanna, you know, talk about what? Gnarling and cleaning and blowing a gun and what deer you shot away the year before? No.
I think that he hit upon some subject matter that a lot of people are afraid to deal with and a lot of people are unaware of.
I found myself a Time magazine where the cover was full of documented minute-by-minute deaths in the United States by people who had a gun. Just started thinking along those lines and then, you know, always pulling back a little and getting simple. You know, run away from the pain.
Let him do it one time so we don't waste a take. Let him try it one time.
We're just doing it on input.
Here we go, we'll try it again.
The first kick entry sounds awkward to me with the double hit.
Little bitty baby, a man has got to be insane.
know, part of me wants to say, what a socially relevant statement this is you finally made, Steven. And the other part says, well, that may be true, but it's really only rock and roll.
Sit down here, and I'll leave the room.
The track is not going to be fucking exactly on the
Joe,
click
you're
track.
You're wrong for going past it. It's just that
well, then what are you moaning about?
Because when you bring it back, the track is dragged. And
that's
it's
when
hold.
You hear the difference is when it pulls back into
well,
the
I don't hear a difference that much where it's going to where it goes like here and then it's
going
to come back.
Joe, you hear a track that's going real exciting and all of a sudden it drags.
Okay. No.
We'll just hear it with the click up.
You're not wrong. It's just that it's not right.
Well, I think one of the things that can really touch everybody's nerves is when you've been working away on an idea that in its raw form sounds really great, but for some reason isn't going on the tape the way it's supposed to sound. And it can get to be a very tense situation because the first question is why it isn't working, and so the next question after that is whose fault is it?
Try to fucking make it so that you could get it. What? So that you guys can do it, and I can come back in and put on what you want. I can't do that now.
What do you mean?
I mean exactly what I just said.
No, you see, then here's the problem.
I can't play that
what
right
you
now.
Just said, I don't understand, so I
can't
said
play that right
reason.
Now, so I told you to do it with the machine, so that later on, I could do make it happen just like that.
But if you can play kind of like this, then let's do it.
Well, but you didn't say that before, man. You said you wanted it just like that.
Yeah, I
and I started to play it like that, and you said, no, I don't want to lock into it like that. So I said, well, then use the machine. How much plainer can that be? I'm not trying to give you a fucking hard time.
The tendency in this band is to be vicious at those points. It's not a gentle kind of sorting out. It's like, you know, let's hunt this thing down and shoot it.
Steven and I go back to high school. Steven is the nervous twitch in my eye. Steven is and can be my worst enemy and my best friend.
You can do it. I'd love to
give you a hard time. Are you sure you were? You think I'm trying to give you a hard time?
I just want the song to be the way that you want it to be, and I can't do that right now.
He can really be a pain in the ass when he wants to be. And he can really be a loving, soulful character when he wants to be.
It's how we make records, and it's how we make the best record we possibly can. One thing that I hope we all maintain is our willingness to be vulnerable when we go into an album project, vulnerable to the kind of criticism that we give each other, vulnerable to the kind of pressure we put on each other. vulnerable to the competition that goes on, because that's what keeps the thing electric. That's what gets the vibe in there and the fire in there is the fact that there's five human beings who are willing to, you know, sort of open themselves up to whatever's going to fly in.
So we owe it to you to give me the benefit of the doubt. Let's go in.
Why?
Come on. They'll keep programming and we'll play. Tom?
Yeah.
Let's play and see if Joe can get it.
Listen. That's good, Joey.
That is so it. That is so big. That is so heavy. Joey, will you marry me? That's so cool.
See, that's like the rag
doll. Boom, 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 boom. Huh. So after these last 3 years of trying to work on these albums and thinking, you know, that, geez, I've lost contact with all that I should know. The only two things I do know is about my sobriety, after taking drugs for all those years, and my music. And I fall back on both of them and talk way out of line too much about the drug thing too much. But when it comes to music and I'm in the studio, I get really pissed off, I get real angry, and I get really mad because the stuff that I'm sure of, I can't explain at the moment. It's like a cake. You talk about the ingredients. People can say, oh, no, 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 no. But the proof is in the pudding, right? In the eating, and the tasting, and the listening in this case. So I get really cranked up about that when they say, listen, get out of here and go in the back. On the other hand, I found out that I work best under pressure because I don't often do my homework, you know. But of all the things I've done on these last two albums, I think I've learned that I'm going to at least promise myself that I'll walk the extra mile every night.
Ideas he comes up with as far as drums goes, guitar goes, bass goes, the guy just never stops, you know. I mean, he's on 24 hours a day and the band is his whole life.
Hey, Steven. Steven! You asshole! We let, you know, like, follow when I play those, the breakdown things, you know?
I know,
mean?
I just...
I don't tell me you know, just say ah, okay.
Joe!
Don't tell me what to do! Having fun!
Part of the, I call it the dynamic tension that goes on between the two of us, because we both hear music and like different things, and I don't think that's changed at all over the years. I think that in the early days, the drugs kind of masked that that's what it was, and it just made it a lot more difficult to deal with each other, you know. But now, no, you know, I don't take it as personally when he doesn't like something that I do, and I don't take it as personally when he's like insistent on doing it his way.
Fucked up the front of that.
No, that little trill I think is wonderful.
No, no, this. It got started, it's supposed to go.
Well, let me see, maybe we just fix that little thing. I like that little trill in the front, though.
No, it's there, it's on another one, though.
No, it isn't.
Yeah, it is.
No.
Oh.
Let me listen.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2.
Nice going, Phrase.
We used to have a lot of problems in this band because emotions would arise out of hangovers, and that's not an irrational way for an emotion to arise, is out of a hangover. It's just gonna get, you're gonna get pain, you know.
In the times when we were down and out, like between 1980 and 1983 or 4, you know, I don't look upon those as very fond memories. At the same time, they're not memories that I'll forget, because they help to keep me where I am today. All the things that we did and partook in the days of our drinking and drugging, I can't say that I regret it, because, you know, it was a big part of the path that enabled us to get on to where we are now. Without going through all of that stuff, we wouldn't be here now, because we wouldn't have had anything to learn from. And it's really easy to be in that place. And fortunately, there was some source of power that made us all realize that within the five of us together, there was something that existed and lived and was very much alive, that was really rare.
It used to be the Aerosmith Lost Weekends, where I would go somewhere with a half a bag of dope, and, you know, and I wouldn't know who it was come Monday morning or where I was. And now I leave there with a song on my heart and a smile on my face, and it becomes a hit, and it's, like, really cool.
The bottom line is, I enjoy music when I'm straight now, and I didn't think I could enjoy it when I was, using drugs. I have to enjoy it first before I can write it or play it. And it was a long while. I mean, when I first started listening to music, I was, you know, straight. I was a teenager, you know, and I felt that rush. And then, you know, you start mixing that with a little booze at parties, and then playing to loosen up, and it becomes part of it. But then you kind of lose that kind of that first hit in the morning feeling that you get when you first hear rock and roll, you know, when you first wake up and you put on Smoke on the Water or something, or Highway Star, and you get that rush of adrenaline. You kind of lose that, you know, it gets masked. And over the years, you just start to rely on the drugs more and more. I did, and until it got to the point where I felt I couldn't write, I couldn't play or enjoy music unless I was jacked on China White, you know. So you have to relearn that, you know, that pure feeling again.
To think that, you know, I'm 42 years old, and I've been around for so long, and I think that I'm supposed to know all this stuff. And they say that from the time you started taking drugs to the time you stop, all those are lost years. And so when you stop taking drugs, you go back to when you're 20, in my case, what, 16. So now I've got 3 years sober, and I'm 17, 18. I'm 19 years old. Of all the things I ever lost, I miss my mind the most.
That makes that plot more interesting.
Yeah. Townsend would be proud.
He would.
You do it by pretending, by letting the kid out. That's why drugs were played such a big role in Aerosmith, and especially in me and my creativity. You know, that was my format, my vehicle, to let me, you know, go blah, 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 and just, you know, fuck around with Joe Perry. Now, I just really let the kid out a lot more, and when I pretend, I go for it. You know, lots of times I'll ask Joe Perry, I'll say, hey, you know, dude looks like a lady. I say, dare I do that? Does this work? He goes, well, you've done it before. What's wrong? Love in an elevator. Write it down. Monkey on my back, you know. If you pretend, you're there. Little kids do it, and they're there. They're in the room quiet for hours. What are you doing? I'm playing with Jackie, and there's no Jackie. You know? But Jackie's in the elevator. Lingerie, second floor. She said, can I see you later? And love you just a little more. I kind of hope we get stuck. Nobody gets out alive. I'll show you how to fax in the mailroom, honey, and have you home by 5.
Oh, good morning, Mr. Tyler. Going down? Second floor, hardware, children's wear, ladies' lingerie. Oh, good morning, Mr. Tyler. Going down?
No, there was nothing but the laugh was good in that. The whole front was no good. Not as good as the second one.
She's back. Fighting
anyway,
attitude,
you know?
Yeah, go for it.
Going down?
Make it lower and sexier.
Longer up. Going down?
Going down?
That's it, even slower.
Going.
That's it, going down. Yeah, make it stop. Perfect.
Hard. Oh, good morning, Mr. Tyler. Going down?
That's real. Oh. That's a. The down, going down is just too close.
Yeah. Her voice is almost cracking like she's nervous, which is good.
Yeah.
Oh, good morning, Mr. Tyler.
Oh, it's yes.
Like, yeah.
She's like Snow White.
Sounds
like
that.
Second floor, hardware, children's wear, ladies' lingerie. Oh, good morning, Mr. Tyler. Going down.
This is the weirdest overdub I've ever
this
done.
Is the greatest. This one. This is the good one. You know what I'd really like to do? Get you, me, Tom, Joe, to get a piece of paper, read something different. Just take a piece of paper, cut it in fours, hand him one, and just read. And do that twice. You know, quietly, quiet reading. And it's a small crowd, then Joe and I talk over that. It's like perfect.
Oh, does that work where you just
God.
Read stuff?
You just rip the paper in fours. You go, take that, and just start reading.
Oh. That's neat.
Yeah.
Tell us when, Trace.
Imagine, if you will.
Yes, the good little creature. How simple is stainless versus carbon?
I mean, you see U.S. Okay.
Many
hours. Sure, your life is there.
What's the possible
you want to do?
You choice
you just want to go outside.
Feel free to carry
on if you want. I'm not cheating on your wife or anything. It's just looking at you. I don't care where you get
rent.
I'm not
going to be home. Traditional.
I'm telling you, that's the way it was. I mean, I'm supposed to get more.
Working like a dog for the boss man. Whoa. Working for the company. Working like a dog for the boss man.
Do you know someone that doesn't love sex? I don't. Steven does. It's not to say that there aren't other people out there that are just as obsessed with it, if you will, as he is. It's just that he has the opportunity to write it and express it in his songs. And the mere fact that as many people relate to his songs as they do is only a positive indication that everybody else is just as obsessed with it as he is.
It definitely speaks to the groin, you know, because, hey, that's us, what can I say?
They tell me that the love is blind, but where am I gonna look? They tell me that the love is blind, I really need a girl like an open book. Read between the lines.
Yeah, you know, I was with these group of women, and we were discussing if men bled, would tampons be free? Very heady discussion. And somehow we immediately jumped to undulating uvulas, and what the hell that might have been. And we were in a hot tub, of course, and I figured that the discussion had been long enough on the subject, and we had to move it up to my bedroom. So we got in the elevator, scantily clad, I might add. And suddenly I dropped my room key. And I had to get down on the floor and pick it up. And you know that commercial where the chocolate meets the peanut butter? our heads met. And the other girl, by the way, was pushing the buttons of every floor, you know, because she was totally inebriated. And suddenly, without notice, the doors opened up and we were in the lobby. And she was buns up and kneeling. I was a wheeling and a dealing. Yeah. And so I had to write it down, right? Memoirs.
Second floor, hardware, children's wear, ladies' lingerie. Oh, good morning, Mr. Tyler. Going down?
That's it. Hold it. Hold on. That's the place. Two. So it goes loving and then down, down, down. Dead and up when I'm going down. Loving and then down. Keep it smooth right to the end. Dead and up and down, 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 down. Yeah. Yeah. So you see what's going on there? You gotta bring us into that, but the band's gonna stay straight, and you're gonna go rat dat daga gach. You can't hear me? Hey, can you get Joey? Turn Joey's cans on, put my vocal in Joey's cans.
Okay, I got you.
You got me now? Okay, we're gonna go 2, 2, 3, 4. Love in an elevator. This is right before the guitar solo. Love in an elevator. Living it up.
I am responsible for the title Pump. It's my fault. It truly is an epic, the whole tale of the title. I came up with the title shortly after our permanent vacation tour had ended. We were having a business meeting, and as usual, I wasn't paid. I was daydreaming, and was looking around at all the titles of our previous albums, which adorn our manager's office. And I'm going, oh, we got to do another one of these now, another, another album. another title, and that's really where Pump originated at that meeting, because I thought the Aerosmith logo reminded me of the old Flying A gasoline sign, and I started to go with the whole gasoline station theme, and I started working with that. I started working with one of the guys at the office, Keith Gard, and I told him about my idea, and you know, and we said, yeah, Pump, just, you know, is it Pumps, is it, and it just became Pump, and we thought it was great, and everybody thought it was great, except the guys in my band.
Well, that's the thing, you know, if this was our first record, it would be, you'd never put Fine on the record, but it being Aerosmith, people are going to go, Fine, what did they call it that for, you know?
And then someone would say, because it's fucked up, insecure, neurotic, and emotional, that's what it stands for, and everybody will go, oh, now I know why they did that.
I mean, it's a chance, that's all. You know, I mean, it's our 14th record, and everything else has been like a really literal, cool rock and roll title. If it was a weak album, it would be one thing, but the album's really strong, you know? So it really doesn't matter what we call it, so why not have some fun with it?
Well, I don't like it. Fine at all. I don't want a record called Fine.
Yeah, but what's your record called? Pump? What the fuck is that?
The names, I mean, I have a list that somewhere in my files, I think there's over 100 titles on it, and people were going crazy. Everybody wants to name the record. It becomes this kind of a challenge.
Okay, back to the drawing boards then.
Because I get the same reaction about Pump.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
As a title?
Mm. Aaron, see, they don't think about it completely about sex, as older folks. It's immediately our minds. My mother couldn't even say it.
Looking up your old address?
No, Pump. She couldn't even say it. She got embarrassed. I mean, when I told her about what the title was for the kids, they think about being pumped up when they hear it. You know, they don't, like, associate it with sex right off.
Yeah.
So it's like, it works better for them, I think.
When Brad first thought of it, you know, the idea, where it came from, I thought it was great. I said, okay, fine, that's good, you know. And then you hear stuff from other people, and no, we don't like it. No, that won't. Yes, no. Oh, because of this. And no, it's too hokey. And then, and on and on. And then you start listening to them. And every time we decide something, we go off and we talk to different people, and it would screw us all up.
There was a survey done by the accounting firm of, Brian and David did a little survey. They asked people five names here. Elevator, Fine, Here's Looking Up Your Old Address, Monkey House, and Pump.
And the survey went from Vancouver to Revere to Southborough.
People were just scraping the bottom of their shoes looking for, you know, inspected by, I mean, anything that came into your head. But Pump did win out, and I just thought it was such a good title, because it said so many things. It was sexual, it was musical, it was 90s, you know.
It's more about the dynamics of the band, that process. It's not even about the title of the album anymore. It's about, you know, who's right and who isn't, you know. Who can make the best argument or be the best politician. It's kind of fun, actually, because it takes pressure off the songs. You know?
Part of the process that we go through, we still have to sell ourselves to the record company, And believe it or not, we actually got up to the studio, and I don't think they were convinced we had the material.
All right, well, let's do the next one here.
You've got this balance going on, where you've got the band pretty much just wanting to do what they like, what they feel, and what makes them feel good. But you've got people that come in from your record company. For instance, in our case, John Kolodner. He's our main contact and our mentor at our record company. And he loves our music. And along with just having a love of the music and enthusiasm for what we're doing, his mind is also thinking, which of these songs do I hear that might get on the radio or that a lot of other people might like to listen to as well. And so he's got to develop a sense of that and encourage the band in certain directions.
To me, that's a real great live tune, real nasty, and Steven just gets out and, you know, rips it out. Good, you know, kind of attitude.
It would be nice if it had some kind of guitar or other hook in it musically, which it doesn't have yet, but you'll have to see how that goes as you're making it.
Yeah.
More than anything, you want to please John Kolodner because, I mean, he's right there with you, really, and he knows what we're capable of. So he's just pushing because, you know, we might get lazy, we might be, you know, our focus can be off. And so John's just going, I know you guys can do better than this, or, you know, it's got to be this way. And you're going, oh, geez, you know, can't we go drive our cars now? You know?
You really should put a chorus in after the first verse.
Oh, I see.
Because that really works, and it doesn't disturb, I mean, I am pleased because it is a compromise between what they want and I want because it doesn't interfere with the rest of the song.
Yeah.
But it needs it because it's going too long before that chorus.
We're always complaining that there isn't enough of it done and how can he make a judgment on a song that doesn't have all the lyrics and, yeah, but we don't have the lyrics. Well, we've got to play it for him anyway. So all that stuff, it's all part of the process and a lot of it's hard.
And even Joe Perry Solo, is that a Perry Solo?
Yes.
I mean, that's going in the right direction.
Oh, it's great. It's
I mean, that's really, I mean, I'm surprised how good that is.
Yeah, the sound on that solo is something you've never heard before.
Which is what this whole album, I mean, already there's a couple songs that don't sound like anything else. I mean, this song doesn't sound like anything that's ever been recorded, which is why I think it's going to get so much attention.
It's real simple. For me now, looking back in retrospect on the whole procedure of creativity, quite often, we who are creating at the time, it's like a painting, and you get stuck by being the painter, by being in the frame, when in reality, the people that buy it and love the painting are standing back a little from it, right? So we being the creators, creative people, are like stuck in the frame and can't see that the colors, the reds are kind of fusing. We like to think it is because, hey, I know everything. I'm the greatest, right? So, but in that process of creativity, which, by the way, there's a lot of lunacy, and not just because the moon is full, it takes somebody like Kolodner or whoever the designated bad guy is to come in and say, hey, no, man, you should, you know, if you don't mind me saying so, you should try that. And John Kolodner's never said anything more than that. You know, I don't like that. You should try doing this there. And it's not finished until you change that lyric. And he'll be to the point, but he says it with love. You know, he knows that we have the bottom line, and he never lets us think any different, which is real good for us. It makes me want him to be even more critical.
Well, I mean, that's truly his masterpiece. I mean, that's really amazing and really bizarre.
Yeah. It really is.
That is really bizarre.
I had no idea that's what that was about.
Yeah. Well, it didn't start out to be that way, but we haven't.
Now I see why the song is so commercial. You might want to change a couple words. I mean, like, he raped, he popped or something.
And
the bullet. I mean, now I see why the discussion came up, because this is the kind of song that's so interesting that people will play it. And if there's it would be a shame to not have it played because of three or four words. I see exactly why the discussion came up. I didn't really understand.
Yeah. Well, let's see how it goes. If he gets something that's cool for those, he could easily say he did a little bitty baby, instead of he raped.
Yeah.
And we could get something for put a bullet in his brain, which basically says the same thing without.
See, now on Run, I mean, in the end, are you going to, it needs, like, this also needs a production kind of thing, like major of some sort.
Yeah. The thing is that we want to leave it hanging with a kind of an ominous feel, like unresolved in a way, so we want to leave the tension.
Because it does stay that way.
Yeah.
But then, okay, that's all right if you want to do that, but then on Runaway, those sections, then they should be orchestrated, or then there should be, then they should have
the big
a George Martin
bigger,
or some. I mean, I understand about the tag because maybe that's how what the song says. But then the choruses and the Runaway parts, the Janie's Got a Gun and the Runaway parts, then they have to be more intense and melodic and, easier to remember if you're going to go out on a weird tag.
But it's not like a big deal, because I know John comes from the heart, and I have a lot of respect for his opinion, there's some things I don't like what he says about stuff, but, when you stand back for a second, I don't get anywhere near as crazed about it as Steven does. I mean, he's like, it's not permanent, and nothing he says is etched in stone, and I don't think it's pronouncing judgment. It's like, he's right and wrong, too, about things, I mean, sometimes he'll take one word out of a lyric and go, that can't be in there. It's terrible. And it's like, sometimes he just needs something to hang his hat on, I guess. But for the most part, he's right, so I respect what he says, And as far as whether I like it as a musician or an artist, if I was that much of a musician or an artist, I'd be playing coffee houses in Cambridge. I'm an entertainer and I play rock and roll in arena rock. And in order to do that, you have to make compromises.
Well, the thing is, I mean, Don't Get Mad and Love and Janie could be a classic song of all time if Bruce can get it right. And then Other Side,
Could be Contender. My Girl could even be Contender if they lay in two, three real strong singles. You could come with My Girl.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Did you get that?
Wait, do it again. Go.
Now suck your toes! It's slowing down, John. Easy on the pie plate bread!
Somebody can kick his ass and make it go. That's great. But on the other hand, it's a tough thing. I mean, we've all tried to write lyrics, and it's not an easy task, so.
No, and of course we all know that he has the best twisted sense of that, but if he would sit down and do it,
he puts his mind to it, right. He fucking writes such great stuff.
I know that.
He needs a little bit of inspiration. I think you're right, John.
That was the most uncomfortable time for me during this album, was when they said, get out of here and finish the songs.
I don't think you need to feel, awkward about not being here for every second of the record. I mean, there's no question about it. Sometimes things happen, but, you know, and things happen when you're not in the room as well, good things. And, you know, there's no harm in that. And besides that, it's nothing that you can't, come over and...
I will come by and visit you
more the better.
Every 25 minutes.
Good. I think that's great. And if you don't like something, we can fix it up.
Yeah, now that's not true. It's shit goes bad. Down, it's down because Johnny's just demos.
Huh?
But that's all right. I can live with it.
Well, you can go stand, keep your backs to the door.
Wait, they still remember how to set mics up, Frank?
Yeah, A
couple times a day.
I hope I'm not tomorrow.
You know what? Nobody's hard enough on it. That's the problem.
The problem with Steven here is if he doesn't have the lyrics finished, it's not a song. You know, so Joe would look at me and say, we'll finish the lyrics, we'll have a song. So, of course, I waited until the very last minute in Vancouver to finish up with those songs, which was pretty good. It got me really pissed off. And that seems to be how I work the best, is under pressure and bummed out and, you know, forced into stuff. That way I get more of me into my art.
Thing. So baby,
elevator doesn't sound exactly...
Yep.
I don't want to go commit suicide.
No, you don't, because the record's great.
Tell me more about how great the record is.
It's great. It sounds like...
anywhere?
Yeah, there's a lot of hits.
How many hits?
Well, let me listen to the whole thing first.
Tell me how much you love me.
You got to know when to stop, too. You know, you can start with the amount of tracks that you can record with 48 tracks, 96 tracks. You can start tying tape machines together. And you got to know when to stop, too. You know, how many horns? Is it an organ or a piano? And that's the real difficult part, I think, is deciding what makes it, when you've got enough, and what works.
Hit the bridge.
You find that? Yeah, so what are you wasting time for? Just do it and we'll fix it in the mix.
Nobody.
Come on up, boys. Ready? One take, we got this.
We're always ready.
Here we go. Here we go.
Smacking, patty, wacky, walking the street. I got a ragtop Chevy in the back of my feet. I get an emo Woody when I'm feeding the beat. Cause I'm ready. So ready. This hooker's down on 42nd Street, but ill-gotten booties. Here we go.
When I do punch-ins or overdubs on a record, you know, I go and just like everybody else, you sit in the control room behind the board with the producer. And, you know, you're kind of sitting here and you've got your instrument here, and immediately right here is Bruce, you know, and he's like staring at you, and you feel his eyes boring into the side of your head saying, come on, come up with your best, let's do it. And then there's Steven will be right over here, and he'll be ready to go, hey, why don't you, and everybody else is kind of around, you know, like, you know, for moral support. And it's really exciting because, you know, you're on the spot. And, you know, it can, you know, for me, I'm a, you know, bass player. I'm used to having my stuff done, down pat, you know, it's the bed of the song and that's it. But all of a sudden, you know, you're on stage. And, you know, for me, I get more stage fright right then probably than, you know, when I'm out in front of 20,000 people.
Insurance.
Tremendous amount of listening goes on, and a real experimentation starts to happen. Because we record live, the band goes in and performs the song, and usually gets it in 1, 2, 3 takes. There's the song. There's everything's there. The overdubbing process comes in. Maybe we'll try a trumpet here, or, you know, you have to get crazy with it. You can't limit yourself. The horizons have to be really far and wide.
First.
write a song like Young Lust. Everybody goes, how can you sing a song about young lust when you're 40? And it's like, you know, how are those kids going to relate to that? And it's not about them. It's about us feeling that young lust and allowing ourselves to feel that, you know, and calling in those feelings that you still have when you're 40. You know, I still have. And it's really a tongue-in-cheek kind of song, but it's still, you know, about, you know, that other side of our lives, you know, that a lot of people my age don't allow themselves anymore. You know, they don't allow themselves the pleasure of listening to rock and roll anymore. You know, it's like they start to believe what society tells them about what you're supposed to do when you're 30 and 35 and 40 and 45 and 50, you know. You're supposed to be, you know, it's all defined by what's on TV and all this stuff. And I don't watch TV, so I don't worry about what the Huxtables are doing, you know what I mean? Or what I'm supposed to be wearing, you know. I can tell a little bit when I drive by the yacht club, but, you know, I never go in there.
This is a proposal for our album cover, okay? You gotta tell me your honest opinion.
How about, Young Lust?
Yeah, I liked it a lot. I mean, you could call the album that and have the two trucks, the cover of Young Lust and the two trucks on top of each other, and that would be totally hilarious.
Don't you like that picture of the two trucks?
Everybody loves that picture. Whoever sees it, they go crazy. Especially if you call it Young Lust, because it's hilarious.
But they're two old trucks.
But I don't see the rock and roll get the rock and roll thing. Here I see the penis and the vagina, and that's...
Hey,
that's how you rock and roll. This, the two trucks fucking, is like, whoa.
And you what does that get to do with rock and roll? I mean, why is that any more rock and roll?
Because pumps is on the side of the truck, and it really doesn't have to mean anything.
I painted this picture of how I got somewhere, and I got there by feeding that fucking monkey on my back. You don't throw those four-letter words, which are in every teenager, I mean every teenager's vocabulary is a four-letter word. Why? Because he can. Same reason a dog licks his balls. Because he can. And it's a cool thing, and mom doesn't like it, but I'm going to say it because she doesn't like it. And so I use those words because they're very descriptive. It's my orange and blacks and fuchsias in my painting of my art. And no Tipper Gore or any of those people are going to tell me I can't use that. Besides which... If they agree with me that drugs is a big problem in the United States, and I ought to know because I did them for enough years and killed myself doing it almost. If they agree with me on that, then they're going to have to listen to me on how to tell my story. Because you're not going to do it by saying no. Just saying no is like saying just cheer up to a manic depressant. It's much deeper than that. And so feeding that fucking monkey on my back is going to make a kid's ears perk up and maybe listen to the lyric. Then those 2 out of 10 that are just going to lollygag along and do nothing are going to maybe get what I'm talking about in that song. And therefore, doing a lot more to the drug problem in the United States than just saying no.
Into the mixing process, and this is the other nice part. If you got this organ part here, just doesn't work. You just go, it's out of there. So you know, the listening—it's the repeated listening, and having a vast knowledge of music too, historically, what works, what doesn't work.
Play the top. Play the top.
Okay.
Just these sections.
there's two stages of when an album is finished. There's the stage where my stuff is finished, and there's the stage where the album is in the can. It's been mixed, mastered, and it's ready to go. In the first case, I didn't want it to end. I had gone into this project pushing myself harder than I ever had, and feeling the energy from the band and from Bruce pushing me harder than ever before. And it was just this big challenge to see how good a record I could make. And having come to the end of my tracks, I felt that I had played better than ever before, that my tracks were better than any record I've played on yet. And so I just felt this satisfaction and this, you know, not only satisfaction, but I just felt so warmed up. I mean, I was ready to go. I was ready to keep doing this. And all of a sudden, it was time for me to be done.
Oh, that's the greatest time of all. For me, that's like, wow, that's like what I work for all year. If you were to ask me when's the time, most people say, when my feet get on the beach of Maui. For me, it's when it's all finished, and I get on that plane, and I got the cassette right here. And it's a finished product, and I go, wow. Because, you know, you work 6 months on an album, and you spend a year and a half touring on it. It's like a wave, and the surfboard's your album, and you got the wave, and you want to ride that sucker all the way to the shore. And so it's finished, and it's the greatest. You know, it's just that feeling of just, I'm so elated at that time that it's a scary place, and I can't wait to get on the road or something else, because it really is a void. It's like the eye of the tornado.
Well, it's just another chapter in the journey, you know what I mean? It's, you know, it was a really good record for us. I mean, I can see the flaws in it and stuff, but, you know, you're only as good as your next record, you know? So, it's just another place to step off to go on to the next thing, you know.
It came time when the album was finished, and here was this group of songs, and I knew how I felt about them, but I had no idea how anybody else in the world was going to react to them. I had no idea if we had the album that we needed to get us beyond the point we were at.
Withstood the test of time, and I don't really know if there are any other tests for us other than ourselves.
Has just allowed us to be a little bit freer than we ever were before. In this world of watch what you say and the PMRC and all that stuff still don't mean shit to a tree. It just allows us to be even freer than we were before, because now we know the freedom isn't just saying the word fuck or whatever. It's getting out of our own way. It's letting the kid out. It's having the freedom to express ourselves.
There's a few things you could do, but it's a fucking masterpiece.
He likes it.
It's amazing.
He likes it! He likes it! Letting out the kid! Woo-hoo, I'm scared now. And I like it.
It's just so safe. It's like, okay, we just spent 6 hours on it. I don't know.
Hey, Steven.
Yo.
Try scouting over that bridge there. Just fucking, just let it fly, you know?
It's all tongue in cheek.
Use some of that use all over it.
To think without a brain.
I'm ready.
Move it!
I knew you'd save that, you bug fucker. Come on.
No, we can all be scared.
Hey, don't take pictures of me picking my nose!
With that attitude, we'll get nowhere.
Now we got something going here. I love this.
A little bass on there.
Hey, Steven.
Don't get mad. Get stupid.
And what was the time on that, Toby?
That's cool. We're over. John Collado will never go to this.
You see, I have cleverly disabled the console remote. Yes, the console remote is now disabled.
But I mean, he has some good ideas. I mean, half the things he thought, his sick fantasies are all in these songs.
I just had three. Why?
So now there's some sushi or something.
Can we get sushi at this time?
Yeah.
I don't want to blow the fare, I just want a blowjob. I don't know.
Yeah,
you need to find one-on-one. Next week. Either this or this. Just give me a fucking click track, okay? And let me just fucking plow straight on through.
Jeez, I blew the end, didn't I? How did I do that? And it's documented.